When markets face uncertainty, investors often turn to forecasts, historical trends, and data models for some sort of guidance. But what happens when the future is so unpredictable that those models don't really work? My next guest says we're now in a moment called Knightian uncertainty, where risk can't even be measured. Jeff Evans is Vice President and Director and Lead of Empirical Research and PM Support at TD Asset Management. He joins me now. I have to tell you, my favorite thing in the world is learning new things. So it's been a real pleasure talking to you before and learning this. Welcome.
Excellent. Thank you very much for having me on.
It is a pleasure. What is Knightian uncertainty?
So this is a concept that goes back to the 1930s. So it probably, you know, gives a little bit of context. It was an uncertain period back then, and that sets the tone for how this was created and kind of what a lot of these economists were thinking about. So there's economist Frank Knight who actually came up with this. And I think the best way to describe it is actually to, let's start with something a little bit more familiar, which would just be risk.
Okay.
So I think most of the people tuning into the show probably have a car, probably have a house or an apartment. And when you have those things, you probably have insurance. Always, you know, important because you just never know. Sometimes something's going to go wrong. Your car might be stolen. You might have a leaky faucet that causes water damage. For any one individual person, you may not know if it's going to happen or not. Whether right. your particular car is stolen, that's a sort of a random roll of the dice. You never know. But from the insurance company's perspective, when you have millions of people, now you can start to calculate the probabilities.
These are what actuaries do all day, day in, day out, right?
Exactly. And you can start to get a sense of, you know, in a typical year, how likely is it for somebody to have their car stolen? How likely is it for your house to be damaged? And then what's the cost to fix it? Mm-hmm. And if you have those two things, you put them together, that's what we would call risk. We don't know what the outcome is for any particular person, but we can basically create an insurance contract. We can price it. Somebody's willing to take the other side of it for you. Knightian uncertainty is a completely different environment where we can't even calculate the probabilities. We just don't even know how likely it is that your car is going to be stolen or how likely it is to have something wrong with your house. And so that's sort of the environment that we're in today, is where you know, you think about some of the things that are happening in the macroeconomy right now, lots of uncertainty around tariffs and changes in policy, lots of uncertainty around sustainability of U.S. debt and the dollar, other geopolitical concerns. There's a lot of different moving parts. Sometimes we can find data on that, sometimes we can't. And, mm-hmm. and really, the last time that this has happened, particularly on the tariffs, was over 100 years ago in the 1930s when the economy was very different than it is today. So that's really the key issue is, you know, risk, you can calculate the probabilities. This is completely different, where we can't even go back and look at past data to try and get even a rough sense of how likely different scenarios or outcomes may be.
Which, I mean, contributes, that is why we see the volatility we see right now, is because the markets are constantly reevaluating, I assume, reacting in real time, right?
Exactly. You're always trying to recalibrate the probabilities. And when you look at what happened in April, you know, for a lot of investors trying to say, well, what's the likely outcome? If the outcome is, I have no idea, are you willing to step in and buy assets at that point in time? And that's where you start to see these really aggressive 10, 20% moves in a short span of time. It's because nobody can actually figure out what the base case is.
But we have had tariffs. We haven't had tariffs for a very long time, in fairness, but, you know, we have had some tariffs. So how do you think about that?
And the fact that we haven't had really a recent history with tariffs
yeah.
at all. So the first challenge is exactly that. We haven't had them. We had a little preview, I guess you could say, in 2018, but on a much smaller scale, on a very small subset of goods, and really targeted on China was the main focus. This is very different. It's much broad-based, or far more broad-based than it was in 2018. We don't know how the global economy is going to react because there's so many more moving parts in that.
Could you take us through your thinking, though? Like, I mean, if you're, because I know you have some thoughts about how do you think about this as a U.S. consumer, right? Like, maybe you can take us through it.
Well, so let's start with what is the tariff? So that's challenge number one. If you're a U.S. consumer and you don't know what the tariff is going to be today or 6 months from now, problem number one is do you make a consumption choice today? Do you buy your car now if you need to? Or is this going to be gone in a year and maybe I'll just delay a little bit? So that's the first challenge. If you're a consumer or a business, figuring out if these are permanent or temporary tariffs is a major challenge. And the response that you have is going to be very different under those two scenarios. Particularly for companies, if it's a temporary tariff, maybe you just absorb this in margins, you help your consumers out, you make sure that there's continued demand, and the tariff is gone in a year. So it's just a little bit of a hit for a short period of time, but your business stays intact. If this is a permanent tax, and it's increasingly seeming like that's the direction that this is going in, the response is probably very different. Why would you, why take the hit now? Or why not just pass it on to a consumer, rip the Band-Aid off, and move on? We just don't know how businesses are going to react to this. And we're hearing very different things from management teams. Some are very concerned about the political pushback if they try to pass this through. Others recognize it as an existential threat. If they don't pass this on, they go to business. Mm-hmm. So there's just a huge range of responses on how businesses respond to this. And then the consumer is a completely different piece, because we don't know how much of this consumption on imports is discretionary versus non-discretionary. Maybe that 10th pair of shoes you really, really need, or maybe we can actually get by without them. There's estimates, and economists have been trying to put some numbers on this as best they can. But when you have a massive shock on this scale, you start to get into non-linearities and scenarios where there is true uncertainty. We don't know how the business reacts, how the consumer reacts, and you put all these things together. Trying to sketch an outcome is very, very difficult to do.
But people still have to estimate, right? And I think what people still have to forecast, and so when you see like the World Bank and the IMF and other major institutions, they're still putting out forecasts. So how do we interpret that? Like what? How do they do it?
Exactly.
And they all look tired, because I've talked to a lot of them. I feel like it's harder than it used to be.
It's been a much tougher year than previous years. So I think the first challenge in an environment like this, just winging it is probably not the right way to do it. Businesses do need some degree of planning at the end of the day. And if you think about a major CEO trying to make investment decisions, staffing decisions.
Which is why we've seen things stop, quite frankly, but yes.
Well, exactly, because there's no certainty on the way things are going to plan out or play out. First of all, if you look at what some of these macro models are doing and the output, the forecasts themselves haven't necessarily changed that much. People are still saying maybe the economy is going to grow 2 to 3%. That average growth is stable. It's the distribution of outcomes that's widening out significantly. And if you take one example, if you look at the Fed in their dot plots back in March, the range of outcomes for US GDP growth was anything between -1 and +5. So if you just think about what that means for a business, you could be in recession with no demand for your product, or you could be in a huge expansion with an enormous amount of demand, and how do you plan?
No supply. Yeah.
Exactly. So it's kind of a fascinating outcome. And if you sort of step back and think about what a lot of these other institutions are doing, everybody still needs to forecast, but the key now is understanding how those forecasts are made. What are the models? What are the assumptions? What are the range of outcomes? And ideally, as people who need to consume these forecasts and try to get some sensibility out of them, we want to try to find forecasts that are using different approaches, different methodologies. If they agree, great. That probably gives us more confidence that that's kind of the direction things are going in. And then if there's disagreements, that can also help inform, maybe particular scenarios we should pay more attention to. The key is really don't take anything at face value. The forecasts are probably wrong. What we're really trying to do is even just get the direction right. That's really what people are grappling with, is it a recession or not?
And I guess I see my producer has spoken to you and have some notes about AI being probably more useful in this kind, because it can just generate so many different outcomes more quickly to understand.
Exactly. And I guess the first thing is, it's also very easy for me to sit here and say it's really important to understand how these complex economic models work. The reality is you'd have to get multiple degrees, a PhD, spend probably 10 years working at the World Bank to really understand how the models work. AI is great. You can toss in some of the technical manuals on these models, and you're never going to fully understand it the way an expert will, but at a high level, you can start to understand the basic assumptions, the strengths, the weaknesses of different models. AI is great for that kind of high-level summary work, and then particularly when you start comparing some of these models, it's not perfect, but it's a really good way if you're trying to, if there's two or three forecasts, you want to understand how they make them, how they get there. AI is great at that. And then, as you said, it's also really good at scenario analysis. We can use the hallucinations that these models have, ask AI to come up with 5 or 6 different scenarios. How would tariffs potentially ripple through the economy? And then we start iterating. We'll pick a particular scenario, dig in a little deeper, test the quality of the assumptions. And so I think it'd be a really interesting tool. It's almost perfect made for this type of scenario where we don't know the probabilities, but we can actually look at maybe broad-based more scenario analysis.
We talked, we're talking about Knightian uncertainty and all the things that are happening. Let's talk about Section 899. And from the lens of, I'll say, American exceptionalism, how does this play into all this from your perspective?
So this is an interesting aspect of the Big Beautiful Bill that was added in that would basically be a tax on dividends that are distributed to foreign holders. So anybody who owns shares in U.S. companies could potentially see the withholding tax rise from, in certain cases, as little as 0 to 5% all the way up to 50% over a period of time.
Which affects Canadians as well, so being foreign, but anyway, yes.
Exactly. And then on top of that, it would be different carve-outs as well for pension funds that have also, in some cases, have no tax. So lots of potential changes for people who have money invested in the United States. There's a few interesting reasons why this has shown up in the bill. One is, if they word it properly, under the way the Congressional Budget Office looks at the bill and the funding, they get to count the revenues. There's lots of other spending things happening in the bill. This would be one area where they get to say, we have revenues coming in. So that's quite important from an optics perspective to help get this bill passed. The flip side of that is, though, it's very important that the wording does not require them to actually enforce this. What the administration is really trying to do is preserve optionality and selectively enforce this if they want to at certain points in time. So the goal, hopefully, is to have this as a negotiating tool. And then really, as you go out over the next 2 or 3 years, if the tariff revenues don't come in line with what the administration was expecting, this is maybe a potential fallback to help backstop revenues and pay for the bill. But I think that's the way we're thinking about it. It was very important just to help get this bill passed from a funding perspective. And at least the way we're thinking about it, it's more of a long-term concern if tariffs don't work out as expected.
If the tariffs and the funding doesn't work out as expected, the debt becomes larger, and we start thinking about, you know, the reserve currency status and all that good stuff. How do you even think about the U.S. if it doesn't become the default destination for capital going forward?
I think the biggest challenge, so first of all, it really comes back to there's so many different moving parts at the moment. The bill on its own is potentially quite concerning. This could be something that blows out the budget deficit quite significantly. What we don't know is what level of tariffs are going to come in, so that'll be an offset. And then you could actually get some economic growth, which offsets as well. We've seen scenarios where you could actually get pretty close to a balanced budget. So there's a wide range of outcomes. It could be an 8% deficit. It could be almost a balanced budget. It's pretty wild. So we need to find that out. And I think that really the only way we're going to do that is to let time go by and see. That uncertainty is a problem. When you have a major destination for capital like the United States that has been founded on rules of law, very sustainable institutions, slow change, we've had a pretty significant shock. And if we can have the shock here, we can have it elsewhere. What we ultimately come back to, though, is when investors start looking for alternatives, what we've seen in our research is that the biggest drivers of stock returns over time are profitability and earnings growth. Ultimately, what investors want is for earnings to go up over time, because that tends to drive stock prices. When we look around the world and try to find other locations that can mirror the U.S., it's very few far and in between. The vast majority of high profitability companies with strong earnings growth are in the U.S., and the few companies that are outside of the U.S., they're profitable because they're selling into the U.S. There's just a very small pool of alternatives. And the big question is, do we start to see some of the follow-on effects from this, of other countries starting to invest? Do we see other different government programs globally to help drive earnings growth? We're not there today, though, and that's the core challenge is there's very few opportunities that have the liquidity and the growth that the U.S. offers.
Okay, so given all this then, and you've given us a lot, I've got about 90 seconds, but in this world of Knightian uncertainty then, you're saying the States still looks pretty compelling compared to everywhere else, but like, what do investors do?
So I think the first is recognize that this is uncertain, and when things are truly uncertain, diversification becomes incredibly important. Spread your investments around. Don't put everything into large cap market weighted indices are heavily skewed to the U.S. It may have performed very well historically. Don't rely on that as the assumption going forward. Really revisit the portfolio and make sure that it's robust to different scenarios. We want lots of assets that will perform well in strong inflation. We want assets that perform well in weak inflation. Doing that stress testing and making sure you have a diversified portfolio is the best way to navigate uncertainty. And then the next most important thing is to be cognizant of what you're paying for these assets. Mm-hmm. When you're paying 30 times earnings, a lot has to go well just to get a 10% return. It's incredibly important in this environment to be aware of valuation. And again, just be cognizant that things may not play out the way the market expects. Having that little extra buffer can make a huge difference.
This is probably an unfair question to ask you with 10 seconds to go, but how long do you expect this uncertainty to last? Are we in a point in time, or is this the beginning of a longer time of uncertainty?
I think it will be a point in time. We will get to a point where tariffs are known, the rates are a little more predictable and stable. We're starting to see the output of tariffs and the impact on economic growth. I think we're going to have a much better handle on this in 1 to 2 years. It'll be bumpy, but I don't think this is going to last indefinitely.